Lewis Carroll. Charles Lutwidge Dodgson, better known by his pen name Lewis Carroll, was an English writer of world-famous children's fiction, notably Alice's Adventures in Wonderland and its sequel Through the Looking Glass. He was noted for his facility at wordplay, logic and fantasy. The poems Jabberwocky and The Hunting of the Snark are classified in the genre of literary nonsense. He was also a mathematician, photographer, and Anglican deacon. Carroll came from a family of High Church Anglicans, and developed a long relationship with Christ Church, Oxford, where he lived for most of his life as a scholar and teacher. Alice Liddell, daughter of the Dean of Christ Church, Henry Liddell, is widely identified as the original for Alice in Wonderland, though Carroll always denied this. Dodgson's family was predominantly Northern English, conservative and High Church Anglican. Most of Dodgson's male ancestors were army officers or Church of England clergy. His great-grandfather, also named Charles Dodgson, had risen through the ranks of the church to become the Bishop of Elphin. His paternal grandfather, another Charles, had been an army captain, killed in action in Ireland in 1803 when his two sons were hardly more than babies. The older of these sons, yet another Charles Dodgson, was Carroll's father. He went to Westminster School and then to Christ Church, Oxford. He reverted to the other family tradition and took holy orders. He was mathematically gifted and won a double first degree, which could have been the prelude to a brilliant academic career. Instead, he married his first cousin Frances Jane Lutwidge in 1830 and became a country parson. Dodgson was born in the small parsonage at Daresbury in Cheshire near the towns of Warrington and Runcorn, the eldest boy but already the third child. Eight more children followed. When Charles was 11, his father was given the living of Croft-on-Tees in North Yorkshire, and the whole family moved to the spacious rectory. This remained their home for the next 25 years. Charles's father was an active and highly conservative cleric of the Church of England who later became the Archdeacon of Richmond and involved himself, sometimes influentially, in the intense religious disputes that were dividing the church. He was High Church, inclining toward Anglo-Catholicism, an admirer of John Henry Newman and the Tractarian movement, and did his best to instill such views in his children. Young Charles was to develop an ambiguous relationship with his father's values and with the Church of England as a whole. During his early youth, Dodgson was educated at home. His reading lists preserved in the family archives testify to a precocious intellect. At the age of 7, he was reading books such as The Pilgrim's Progress. He also suffered from a stammer, a condition shared by most of his siblings that often influenced his social life throughout his years. At the age of 12, he was sent to Richmond Grammar School at nearby Richmond. In 1846, Dodgson entered Rugby School, where he was evidently unhappy, as he wrote some years after leaving. "I cannot say that any earthly considerations would induce me to go through my 3 years again. I can honestly say that if I could have been secure from annoyance at night, the hardships of the daily life would have been comparative trifles to bear." Dodgson did not claim he suffered from bullying, but cited little boys as the main targets of older bullies at rugby. Stuart Dodgson Collingwood, who was Dodgson's nephew, wrote that even though it is hard for those who have only known him as the gentle and retiring Don to believe it, it is nevertheless true that long after he left school, his name was remembered as that of a boy who knew well how to use his fists in defense of a righteous cause, which is the protection of the smaller boys. Scholastically, though, he excelled with apparent ease. "I have not had a more promising boy at his age since I came to rugby," observed mathematics master R.B. Mayer. Francis Walking Ames, the tutor's assistant, being a compendium of arithmetic, the mathematics textbook that the young Dodgson used still survives, and it contained an inscription in Latin, which translates to, "This book belongs to Charles Lutwidge Dodgson, hands off." Some pages also included annotations such as the one found in p. 129, where he wrote "not a fair question" in decimals next to a question. He left rugby at the end of 1849 and matriculated at the University of Oxford in May 1850 as a member of his father's old college, Christ Church. After waiting for rooms in college to become available, he went into residence in January 1851. He had been at Oxford only 2 days when he received a summons home. His mother had died of inflammation of the brain, perhaps meningitis or a stroke, at the age of 47. His early academic career veered between high promise and irresistible distraction. He did not always work hard but was exceptionally gifted, and achievement came easily to him. In 1852, he obtained first-class honors in mathematics moderations and was shortly thereafter nominated to a studentship by his father's old friend Canon Edward Pusey. In 1854, he obtained first-class honors in the final honors school of mathematics, standing first on the list, graduating Bachelor of Arts. He remained at Christ Church studying and teaching, but the next year he failed an important scholarship through his self-confessed inability to apply himself to study. Even so, his talent as a mathematician won him the Christ Church Mathematical Lectureship in 1855, which he continued to hold for the next 26 years. Despite early unhappiness, Dodgson was to remain at Christ Church, in various capacities, until his death, including that of sub-librarian of the Christ Church Library, where his office was close to the deanery, where Alice Liddell lived. The young adult Charles Dodgson was about 6 feet tall and slender, and he had curly brown hair and blue or gray eyes. He was described in later life as somewhat asymmetrical, and as carrying himself rather stiffly and awkwardly, although this might be on account of a knee injury sustained in middle age. As a very young child, he suffered a fever that left him deaf in one ear. At the age of 17, he suffered a severe attack of whooping cough, which was probably responsible for his chronically weak chest in later life. Another defect which he carried into adulthood was what he referred to as his hesitation, a stammer that he acquired in early childhood and which plagued him throughout his life. The stammer has always been a significant part of the image of Dodgson. It is said that he stammered only in adult company and was free and fluent with children, but there is no evidence to support this idea. Many children of his acquaintance remembered the stammer, while many adults failed to notice it. Dodgson himself seems to have been far more acutely aware of it than most people whom he met. It is said that he caricatured himself as the Dodo in Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, referring to his difficulty in pronouncing his last name, but this is one of the many facts often repeated for which no first-hand evidence remains. He did indeed refer to himself as the Dodo, but whether or not this reference was to his stammer is simply speculation. Dodgson's stammer did trouble him, but it was never so debilitating that it prevented him from applying his other personal qualities to do well in society. He lived in a time when people commonly devised their own amusements and when singing and recitation were required social skills, and the young Dodgson was well equipped to be an engaging entertainer. He reportedly could sing tolerably well and was not afraid to do so before an audience. He was adept at mimicry and storytelling, and was reputedly quite good at charades. In the interim between his early published writings and the success of the Alice books, Dodgson began to move in the Pre-Raphaelite social circle. He first met John Ruskin in 1857 and became friendly with him. He developed a close relationship with Dante Gabriel Rossetti and his family, and also knew William Holman Hunt, John Everett Millais, and Arthur Hughes, among other artists. He knew fairy tale author George MacDonald well. It was the enthusiastic reception of Alice by the young MacDonald children that persuaded him to submit the work for publication. In broad terms, Dodgson has traditionally been regarded as politically, religiously, and personally conservative. Martin Gardner labels Dodgson as a Tory who was awed by lords and inclined to be snobbish towards inferiors. The Reverend W. Tuckwell, in his Reminiscences of Oxford, regarded him as austere, shy, precise, absorbed in mathematical reverie, watchfully tenacious of his dignity, stiffly conservative in political, theological, social theory, his life mapped out in squares like Alice's landscape. Dodgson was ordained a deacon in the Church of England on December 22, 1861. In the Life and Letters of Lewis Carroll, the editor states that his diary is full of such modest depreciations of himself and his work, interspersed with earnest prayers that God would forgive him the past, and help him to perform his holy will in the future. When a friend asked him about his religious views, Dodgson wrote in response that he was a member of the Church of England, but doubt if he was fully a high churchman. He added, "I believe that when you and I come to lie down for the last time, if only we can keep firm hold of the great truths Christ taught us, our own utter worthlessness and his infinite worth, and that he has brought us back to our one Father, and made us his brethren, and so brethren to one another, we shall have all we need to guide us through the shadows. Most assuredly I accept to the full the doctrines you refer to, that Christ died to save us, that we have no other way of salvation open to us but through his death, and that it is by faith in him, and through no merit of ours, that we are reconciled to God, and most assuredly I can cordially say, I owe all to him who loved me, and died on the cross of Calvary." Dodgson also expressed interest in other fields. He was an early member of the Society for Psychical Research, and one of his letters suggests that he accepted as real what was then called thought reading. Dodgson wrote some studies of various philosophical arguments. In 1895, he developed a philosophical regressus argument on deductive reasoning in his article What the Tortoise Said to Achilles, which appeared in one of the early volumes of Mind. The article was reprinted in the same journal 100 years later in 1995, with a subsequent article by Simon Blackburn titled Practical Tortoise Raising. From a young age, Dodgson wrote poetry and short stories, contributing heavily to the family magazine Miskmash and later sending them to various magazines, enjoying moderate success. Between 1854 and 1856, his work appeared in the national publications The Comic Times and The Train, as well as smaller magazines such as the Whitby Gazette and the Oxford Critic. Most of this output was humorous, sometimes satirical, but his standards and ambitions were exacting. "I do not think I have yet written anything worthy of real publication, but I do not despair of doing so someday," he wrote in July 1855. Sometime after 1850, he did write puppet plays for his siblings' entertainment, of which one has survived, La Guida de Brega. In 1856, he published his first piece of work under the name that would make him famous. A romantic poem called Solitude appeared in The Train under the authorship of Lewis Carroll. This pseudonym was a play on his real name. Lewis was the anglicized form of Ludovicus, which was the Latin for Lutwich, and Carroll an Irish surname similar to the Latin name Carolus, from which comes the name Charles. The transition went as follows. Charles Lutwich translated into Latin as Carolus Ludovicus. This was then translated back into English as Carroll Lewis and then reversed to make Lewis Carroll. This pseudonym was chosen by editor Edmund Yates from a list of 4 submitted by Dodgson, the others being Edgar Cuthwellis, Edgar UC Westhill, and Lewis Carroll. In 1856, Dean Henry Liddell arrived at Christ Church, bringing with him his young family, all of whom would figure largely in Dodgson's life over the following years, and would greatly influence his writing career. Dodgson became close friends with Liddell's wife Lorena and their children, particularly the 3 sisters Lorena, Edith, and Alice Liddell. He was widely assumed for many years to have derived his own Alice from Alice Liddell. The acrostic poem at the end of Through the Looking Glass spells out her name in full, and there are also many superficial references to her hidden in the text of both books. It has been noted that Dodgson himself repeatedly denied in later life that his little heroine was based on any real child, and he frequently dedicated his works to girls of his acquaintance, adding their names in acrostic poems at the beginning of the text. Gertrude Chataway's name appears in this form at the beginning of The Hunting of the Snark, and it is not suggested that this means that any of the characters in the narrative are based on her. Information is scarce, but it seems clear that his friendship with the Liddell family was an important part of his life in the late 1850s, and he grew into the habit of taking the children on rowing trips accompanied by an adult friend to nearby Nuneham Courtenay or Godstow. It was on one such expedition on July 4, 1862 that Dodgson invented the outline of the story that eventually became his first and greatest commercial success. He told the story to Alice Liddell and she begged him to write it down, and Dodgson eventually presented her with a handwritten, illustrated manuscript entitled Alice's Adventures Underground in November 1864. Before this, the family of friend and mentor George MacDonald read Dodgson's incomplete manuscript, and the enthusiasm of the MacDonald children encouraged Dodgson to seek publication. In 1863, he had taken the unfinished manuscript to Macmillan the publisher, who liked it immediately. After the possible alternative titles were rejected, Alice Among the Fairies and Alice's Golden Hour, the work was finally published as Alice's Adventures in Wonderland in 1865 under the Lewis Carroll pen name, which Dodgson had first used some 9 years earlier. The illustrations this time were by Sir John Tenniel. Dodgson evidently thought that a published book would need the skills of a professional artist. Annotated versions provide insights into many of the ideas and hidden meanings that are prevalent in these books. Critical literature has often proposed Freudian interpretations of the book as a descent into the dark world of the subconscious, as well as seeing it as a satire upon contemporary mathematical advances. The overwhelming commercial success of the first Alice book changed Dodgson's life in many ways. The fame of his alter ego Lewis Carroll soon spread around the world. He was inundated with fan mail and with sometimes unwanted attention. Indeed, according to one popular story, Queen Victoria herself enjoyed Alice in Wonderland so much that she commanded that he dedicate his next book to her, and was accordingly presented with his next work, a scholarly mathematical volume entitled An Elementary Treatise on Determinants. Dodgson himself vehemently denied this story, commenting, "It is utterly false in every particular. Nothing even resembling it has occurred, and it is unlikely for other reasons." As T.B. Strong comments in a Times article, it would have been clean contrary to all his practice to identify author of Alice with the author of his mathematical works. He also began earning quite substantial sums of money but continued with his seemingly disliked post at Christ Church. Late in 1871, he published the sequel Through the Looking Glass, and What Alice Found There. Its somewhat darker mood possibly reflects changes in Dodgson's life. His father's death in 1868 plunged him into a depression that lasted some years. In 1876, Dodgson produced his next great work, The Hunting of the Snark, a fantastical nonsense poem exploring the adventures of a bizarre crew of 9 tradesmen and 1 beaver, who set off to find the snark. It received largely mixed reviews from Carroll's contemporary reviewers, but was enormously popular with the public, having been reprinted 17 times between 1876 and 1908, and has seen various adaptations into musicals, opera, theater, plays and music. Painter Dante Gabriel Rossetti reputedly became convinced that the poem was about him. In 1895, 30 years after publication of his masterpieces, Carroll attempted a comeback, producing a 2-volume tale of the fairy siblings Sylvie and Bruno. Carroll entwines 2 plots set in 2 alternative worlds, one set in rural England and the other in the fairytale kingdoms of Elfland, Outland, and others. The fairytale world satirizes English society, and more specifically the world of academia. Sylvie and Bruno came out in 2 volumes and is considered a lesser work, although it has remained in print for over a century. In 1856, Dodgson took up the new art form of photography under the influence first of his uncle Skeffington Lutwidge, and later of his Oxford friend Reginald Southey. He soon excelled at the art and became a well-known gentleman photographer, and he seems even to have toyed with the idea of making a living out of it in his very early years. A study by Roger Taylor and Edward Wakeling exhaustively lists every surviving print, and Taylor calculates that just over half of his surviving work depicts young girls, though about 60% of his original photographic portfolio is now missing. Dodgson also made many studies of men, women, boys, and landscapes. His subjects also include skeletons, dolls, dogs, statues, paintings, and trees. His pictures of children were taken with a parent in attendance, and many of the pictures were taken in the Liddell Garden because natural sunlight was required for good exposures. He also found photography to be a useful entree into higher social circles. During the most productive part of his career, he made portraits of notable sitters such as John Everett Millais, Ellen Terry, Dante Gabriel Rossetti, Julia Margaret Cameron, Michael Faraday, Lord Salisbury, and Alfred Tennyson. By the time that Dodgson abruptly ceased photography, he had established his own studio on the roof of Tom Quad, created around 3,000 images, and was an amateur master of the medium, though fewer than 1,000 images have survived time and deliberate destruction. He stopped taking photographs because keeping his studio working was too time-consuming. He used the wet collodion process. Commercial photographers who started using the dry plate process in the 1870s took pictures more quickly. Popular taste changed with the advent of modernism, affecting the types of photographs that he produced. To promote letter writing, Dodgson invented the Wonderland postage stamp case in 1889. This was a cloth-backed folder with 12 slots, two marked for inserting the most commonly used penny stamp, and one each for the other current denominations up to 1 shilling. The folder was then put into a slipcase decorated with a picture of Alice on the front and the Cheshire Cat on the back. It intended to organize stamps wherever one stored their writing utensils. Carroll expressly notes in 8 or 9 wise words about letter writing, it is not intended to be carried in a pocket or purse, as the most common individual stamps could easily be carried on their own. The pack included a copy of a pamphlet version of this lecture. Another invention was a writing tablet called the Nictograph that allowed note-taking in the dark, thus eliminating the need to get out of bed and strike a light when one woke with an idea. The device consisted of a grid card with 16 squares and system of symbols representing an alphabet of Dodgson's design, using letter shapes similar to the graffiti writing system on a palm device. He also devised a number of games, including an early version of what today is known as Scrabble. He appears to have invented or at least certainly popularized the doublet, a form of brain teaser that is still popular today, changing one word into another by altering one letter at a time, each successive change always resulting in a genuine word. For instance, cat is transformed into dog by the following steps: cat, cot, dot, dog. The games and puzzles of Lewis Carroll were the subject of Martin Gardner's March 1960 Mathematical Games column in Scientific American. Other items include a rule for finding the day of the week for any date, a means for justifying right margins on a typewriter, a steering device for a velocium, new systems of parliamentary representation, fairer elimination rules for tennis tournaments, a new sort of postal money order, rules for reckoning postage, rules for a win in betting, rules for dividing a number by various divisors, a cardboard scale for the senior common room at Christ Church which, held next to a glass, ensured the right amount of liqueur for the price paid, a double-sided adhesive strip to fasten envelopes or mount things in books, a device for helping a bedridden invalid to read from a book placed sideways, and at least 2 ciphers for cryptography. Within the academic discipline of mathematics, Dodgson worked primarily in the fields of geometry, linear and matrix algebra, mathematical logic, and recreational mathematics, producing nearly a dozen books under his real name. Dodgson also developed new ideas in linear algebra, probability, and the study of elections and committees. Some of this work was not published until well after his death. His occupation as mathematical lecturer at Christ Church gave him some financial security. His mathematical work attracted renewed interest in the late 20th century. Martin Gardner's book on logic machines and diagrams and William Warren Bartley's posthumous publication of the second part of Dodgson's symbolic logic book have sparked a re-evaluation of Dodgson's contributions to symbolic logic. Robbins and Rumsey's investigation of Dodgson condensation, a method of evaluating determinants, led them to the alternating sign matrix conjecture, now a theorem. The algorithm known as Dodgson condensation is closely related to the Schur complement and the Desnoyers-Jacobi identity. The discovery in the 1990s of additional ciphers that Dodgson had constructed, in addition to his Memoria Tech Nica, showed that he had employed sophisticated mathematical ideas in their creation. Dodgson wrote and received as many as 98,721 letters, according to a special letter register which he devised. He documented his advice about how to write more satisfying letters in a missive entitled 8 or 9 Wise Words About Letter Writing. Dodgson's existence remained little changed over the last 20 years of his life, despite his growing wealth and fame. He continued to teach at Christ Church until 1881 and remained in residence there until his death. The two volumes of his last novel, Sylvie and Bruno, were published in 1889 and 1893, but the intricacy of this work was apparently not appreciated by contemporary readers. It achieved nothing like the success of the Alice books, with disappointing reviews and sales of only 13,000 copies. The only known occasion on which he traveled abroad was a trip to Russia in 1867 as an ecclesiastic, together with the Reverend Henry Liddon. He recounts the travel in his Russian journal, which was first commercially published in 1935. On his way to Russia and back, he also saw different cities in Belgium, Germany, partitioned Poland, and France. He died of pneumonia following influenza on January 14, 1898 at his sister's home, the Chestnuts, in Guildford. He was 2 weeks away from turning 66 years old. His funeral was held at the nearby St. Mary's Church. He is buried in Guildford at the Mount Cemetery. Some late 20th century biographers have suggested that Dodgson's interest in children had an erotic element, including Morton N. Cohen in his Lewis Carroll, A Biography, Donald Thomas in his Lewis Carroll, A Portrait with Background, and Michael Bakewell in his Lewis Carroll, A Biography. Cohen, in particular, speculates that Dodgson's sexual energies sought unconventional outlets, and further writes, "We cannot know to what extent sexual urges lay behind Charles's preference for drawing and photographing children in the nude. He contended the preference was entirely aesthetic. But given his emotional attachment to children as well as his aesthetic appreciation of their forms, his assertion that his interest was strictly artistic is naive. He probably felt more than he dared acknowledge, even to himself." Cohen goes on to note that Dodgson apparently convinced many of his friends that his attachment to the nude female child form was free of any eroticism, but adds that later generations look beneath the surface. He argues that Dodgson may have wanted to marry the 11-year-old Alice Liddell, and that this was the cause of the unexplained break with the family in June 1863, an event for which other explanations are offered. Biographers Derek Hudson and Roger Lancelin Green stop short of identifying Dodgson as a pedophile, but they concur that he had a passion for small female children and next to no interest in the adult world. Catherine Robson refers to Carroll as the Victorian era's most famous girl lover. Several other writers and scholars have challenged the evidential basis for Cohen's and others' views about Dodgson's sexual interests. Leba Illy has endeavored to set Dodgson's child photography within the Victorian child cult, which perceived child nudity as essentially an expression of innocence. Leba Illy claims that studies of child nudes were mainstream and fashionable in Dodgson's time, and that most photographers made them as a matter of course, including Oscar Gustav Rijnlander and Julia Margaret Cameron. Leba Illy continues that child nudes even appeared on Victorian Christmas cards, implying a very different social and aesthetic assessment of such material. Leba Illy concludes that it has been an error of Dodgson's biographers to view his child photography with 20th or 21st century eyes, and to have presented it as some form of personal idiosyncrasy, when it was in fact a response to a prevalent aesthetic and philosophical movement of the time. Caroline Leach's reappraisal of Dodgson focused in particular on his controversial sexuality. She argues that the allegations of pedophilia rose initially from a misunderstanding of Victorian morals, as well as the mistaken idea fostered by Dodgson's various biographers that he had no interest in adult women. She termed the traditional image of Dodgson the Carroll myth. She drew attention to the large amounts of evidence in his diaries and letters that he was also keenly interested in adult women, married and single, and enjoyed several relationships with them that would have been considered scandalous by the social standards of his time. She also pointed to the fact that many of those whom he described as child friends were girls in their late teens and even twenties. She argues that suggestions of pedophilia emerged only many years after his death, when his well-meaning family had suppressed all evidence of his relationships with women in an effort to preserve his reputation, thus giving a false impression of a man interested only in little girls. Similarly, Leach points to a 1932 biography by Langford Reed as the source of the dubious claim that many of Carroll's female friendships ended when the girls reached the age of 14. In addition to the biographical works that have discussed Dodgson's sexuality, there are modern artistic interpretations of his life and work that do so as well. In particular, Dennis Potter in his play Alice and his screenplay for the motion picture Dream Child, and Robert Wilson in his film Alice. Dodgson had been groomed for the ordained ministry in the Church of England from a very early age and was expected to be ordained within 4 years of obtaining his master's degree, as a condition of his residency at Christ Church. He delayed the process for some time but was eventually ordained as a deacon on December 22, 1861. But when the time came a year later to be ordained as a priest, Dodgson appealed to the dean for permission not to proceed. This was against college rules and, initially, Dean Liddell told him that he would have to consult the college ruling body, which would almost certainly have resulted in his being expelled. For unknown reasons, Liddell changed his mind overnight and permitted Dodgson to remain at the college in defiance of the rules. Dodgson never became a priest, unique amongst senior students of his time. There is currently no conclusive evidence about why Dodgson rejected the priesthood. Some have suggested that his stammer made him reluctant to take the step, because he was afraid of having to preach. Wilson quotes letters by Dodgson describing difficulty in reading lessons and prayers rather than preaching in his own words. But Dodgson did indeed preach in later life, even though not in priest's orders, so it seems unlikely that his impediment was a major factor affecting his choice. Wilson also points out that the Bishop of Oxford, Samuel Wilberforce, who ordained Dodgson, had strong views against clergy going to the